that what? The Great Commission? We call it the Great Commission. That's our order. You know, it's amazing to me. I hear people say all the time, I'm trying to learn what God's purpose is for my life. I know he has a purpose for me. These are believers talking. Some of you have said the same thing. I know he has a purpose. Well, let me just inform you. That purpose is to go and make disciples. That's your purpose as a believer, as one who's saved, as a disciple of Christ. He said, go and make disciples of all nations. Now, that go is a participle. Okay? Literally, it says, literally, in the Greek, it reads, really, going or as you go. In other words, as you go, do what? Tell somebody about Jesus. If you're in the supermarket, tell somebody about Jesus. Start a conversation, talk about Jesus. You'd be surprised if you pray that the Lord will send somebody to you. It will happen. Our purpose is to do what? Evangelize as good stewards. That's our purpose. So, but also we are all members of God's special arrangements in his church. Stay with me here. Okay. To prove that, read for me. Come on. Right, come on.
Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has special functions, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other.
Read that again. We are what?
Many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other.
We all belong to who?
Each other.
We all belong to each other. Did you get that? We belong to each other. We depend on each other. We engage in the process of building one another up, not tearing one another down. Therefore, there is no room in the body. When we speak of the body, we're speaking of the church. In this context, we're speaking of the church. For competition, jealousy, envy, backbiting, bitterness, lying to one another, lying on one another, bitterness, lying on one another, bitterness, malice, lying on one another, or lying to one another. There's no room, because we depend on who? Each other, one another. Amen? And so, let's just backtrack here right quick. We are all members of God's special arrangement in his church. If you're a member of the local church, it's not by accident that you're a member of that church. It's not incidental that you're a member of that church. God has a purpose for you being a member, and therefore you are to use the tools, the gifts he's given you through that church. That all the members of that church might be what? Might be edified or built up. You still with me here? All right, so therefore, check out Romans 3. Our stewardship tasks, duties, and ministries are according to God's design, will, and he gives every steward the ability to perform a task. Write that in, the ability. We all have been given an ability, been given the ability to perform the task. We've all been given the ability to go and witness and share Jesus to anyone. We have that ability, we have those gifts. To prove that, let's look at Romans chapter 12, verses 6 through 8 in the Living Translation. Read it for me, come on.
Spirit, who is the source of them all. There are clear minds of service.
not redeemed.
Now, where?
The Holy Spirit is in God's power to redeem us and the need of helping to our church.
Now, what does this have to do with stewardship and evangelism process? Here's the commentary. God has placed us in his church and anointed each of us with specific tasks. He's arranged it. Can I share this with you? If you belong to this church or any other church, again, you're not there by accident. You're there with purpose to do what? To use the ability he's given to you, those special spiritual gifts, to work through that church. Amen. That's why it's important to not miss the meeting. That's why it's important to be at church regularly, Bible study, so that you can hear your pastor teach, so that you might learn, hear one voice. Are you with me here? And so, God has arranged each one of us in his body, the church. Every believer has at least one spiritual gift. Stay with me? All right, some have more than one. But then, notice here, there is no dividing line between the message, the mandate, and the mission. No dividing line. They are tied inextricably together. Did you get that? They are tied inextricably together. The message, the mandate, and the mission. Now, when we talk about the message, what are we talking about? Can anybody tell me? The message, what are we talking about? You have the authority. You have authority. You've been given the authority to proclaim the message of Jesus. What is the message? The gospel. Thank you. The gospel. What is the gospel? Death, burial, and resurrection of who? Of Christ Jesus. We have the authority to tell that message to anyone who will listen, to anyone we share it with. That's the message. There's no dividing line between the message, the mission. Are you with me? So the message is about Jesus, the gospel. What is the gospel again?
Death, burial, and resurrection of Christ Jesus.
All right, so we have good news. Thank you. It is good news.
Yes, sir.
It is the good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? All right, stay with me. I say we have the authority. Let's read Acts 1:8. Now Jesus spoke these words just before he called a cloud back to glory. And he said to those disciples that we are an extension of those disciples. He says, and ye shall receive power, authority, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be what?
Witnesses.
To me. Who is the me in the text?
Jesus.
Jesus. Where? In Jerusalem. And in Judea and Samaria. This he spoke to his disciples. But as I said, we are extensions of those disciples. So actually the message refers to who? It wasn't written to us, but of course it's written for us. And as a result, it's our duty to do what? Carry it on. Carry it on. And the mission is what? To the end of the age. If you're a disciple of Jesus, you are held accountable to tell somebody about Jesus. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Cut off the television. Soap operas and all that kind of stuff. And prepare yourselves concerning the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
We have been mandated to implement the ministry. Did you get that? We've been mandated to do what? Anybody tell me what the word implement means? Put it into action. Any other definition? Huh? Execute it. Go to work. As good stewards, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here we go. We have been instructed how to give. How to give as a means to what?
Finance
what? The ministry. That seems to be a problem. Because anytime you start talking about kids, it gets quiet. I was hoping it wouldn't happen here tonight, but it got quiet. I didn't hear not one amen. But if you are a disciple of Jesus, you are held accountable for making sure that the ministry is financed. What I mean when I say the ministry is financed? Well, you know, discipling new converts, pamphlets, books, it costs money. Pastor White had to stop and get some more of these things run off. They didn't give it to him free. He didn't walk in and say, hey, I need about 60 more of these. Thank you, guys. I really appreciate it. What's the cost? They didn't say, it's free, Pastor. No, it costs. Amen. That's our responsibility to make sure there's enough finances to finance the ministry. Little books that you put out there, witnessing books. Are you with me?
Yes.
He'll talk about more of that later on concerning what it takes for the ministry, evangelism ministry. But we have been instructed how to give as a means to finance the ministry. Let's go with it. Here we go. Bring all the tithes. How many tithers we got in here? You know, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Come on, brother, you can do a little holy dance right here. I hope y'all ain't lying to me. All right, I'll be, okay. You know, there are some who suggest that tithing is under the law, but I'm one who's convinced that tithing is a timeless concept. No place in God's word do I read where he does not begin with or. Every aspect about his being and what he does is done according to order. You mean to tell me that money is the only thing where there's no order? When it comes to giving, you can just give as you please. And when they talk about grace giving, let me tell you what grace giving does. All grace giving does is surpasses the tithe. But it's a timeless concept. Now, I don't know what your position is, okay, but my position is it works for me.
Amen.
I say it works for me. Anybody else it works for?
Amen.
I've been a tither ever since I've been saved. Before I got saved, I didn't know what I was doing, but as a kid, my daddy would give me a dollar. He made it clear the first dime went to the church. Amen. He said, that's the Lord's dime. Now, don't take the 90 and just buy some suckers and some candy and cookies. Give an offering. Somebody else.
That's
my first night. I'm trying to walk this. I got to get used to it. All right? And I learned that lesson early in my life. Are you with me here? When I got saved, the first thing I did was pay the tithe. Give it back to him who it belongs to. Because the book says in Leviticus, it is holy.
Amen.
Unto him, which means he has separated that part of my income for his use. Watch me now, and he's the only one. I'm about to get happy.
Right.
Who has the right to tell me how to use it?
Yeah.
Are y'all with me here?
Yes.
We're trying to tell the pastor how the tithe is supposed to be used. God is the only one who tells us, and he does it through his word, how it is to be used.
Yes.
Are y'all with me here?
Yes.
All right. Couple that with, I'm getting used to y'all. First night, we'll get to rolling. Stay with me until Wednesday night, you'll see something. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 2. Read for me. How are we going to finance this ministry? Ministry of evangelism. Well, first of all, we're going to start tithing, all of us.
Yes.
You, those of you who didn't raise your hands, y'all be shaming yourself. Having fun, don't y'all get angry with me. Don't bug me out. I got my ticket in my briefcase. Right? Don't get mad if you try to chase me out of here because I don't want to get to the airport, too. I called, is it Uber? I'm not calling. I'm just having fun with you, but you ought to be ashamed of yourself. If your pastor's been teaching you about the first tenth belongs to the Lord, somewhere on the line you ought to be doing it. Are you with me? If you can go to bed at night and wake up every morning and don't know while you were asleep that you were being kept, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Still got a job. Come on, somebody. Working 5 or 6 days a week, still get income. And you mean to tell me that's more important than what God has instructed us to do? You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Food on your table. Clothes on your back. Nobody came in here without any clothes on their back. You had clothes on your back. Amen. And you mean to tell me you're going to try to figure all this stuff out by yourself? A disciple is a learner. And he follows.
Amen.
Now, in this text here, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, what is the first day of the week? And don't you say Monday?
Sunday.
Huh? When is the first day of the week?
Sunday.
So that means Sunday's not a part of what we call commonly the weekend. I'll get you somewhere. That's the weekend. Huh? Come on, talk back to me. So when you plan your weekend and it includes Sunday, something wrong with that picture. Something wrong with that picture. Where are you supposed to be on Sunday? Huh? In somebody's worship, at least worshiping, right? And that's the time we bring the tithes unto the Lord, right? That's the time we bring an offering as a means of worship, right? That's the day that the finance is supposed to come in. Of course, you can give unbiased, you can give whatever, but on Sunday, Paul was clear. He said, on the first day of the week. And we won't get into the context. I'm just trying to make this bring clarity to this. On the first day of the week, he says, let each of you. Now, he was speaking to the church of Corinth, right?
He
was speaking to that membership, the congregation. So, each one of you, whether it's Mount Moriah, Mount Olive, help me out.
Second
Baptist, help me.
Calvary.
Friendship. Oh, let me tell you, supposed to be more folk in here.
Morningstar.
Huh? Morningstar. All these sections. Supposed to be more folk in here. Amen.
Yeah.
See, when you miss the meeting, you're going to miss the message.
Yeah. All right.
Say that.
Well, I wish you'd have been here yesterday. This idea that you think you can do what you want to do. I have rights. No, you have responsibility.
Amen.
Your responsibility on the first day of the week is to be what? In worship to hear the message so God can speak to us. He doesn't have a select folk he speak to on Sunday morning, but he speaks to that whole congregation on the first day of the week. Bring the tithe on the first day of the week. Bring it off on the first of the week. Bring the money so we can what? Have finances for the ministry. Can I slide this in? I know it's not in the message. And the minister. The ministry and the minister. Is that all right? He said, let each of you. I do something real quick. Take your left hand and the right hand. Take that little finger there. And look at your neighbor and say, he talking about you too. Come on. Some of y'all not cooperating. Y'all mad at me already? Some of you ain't cooperating. You look at me like this. Don't get mad at me because God is speaking through me and you don't want to hear me. You ought to be able to say, speak louder, Pastor. Yes, I'm guilty. Help me out so that when I come back on Sunday, I'm ready.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to come back on Sunday. You can do it tonight.
All right.
Okay. I'm sure Dr. White will give you an envelope to give to your pastor with your money in. If you miss tithing on this past Sunday. Is that right?
Yes,
pastors, won't you accept it tonight?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You have to go home mad.
Yes,
That man made me so mad I couldn't help myself. I just had to give it. Well, if that makes you mad, all right, then don't you give it. Because my Bible says God loves a cheerful giver, one who's full of joy. Amen. All right. Let each of you lay something aside. Don't spend up all your money.
Lord Jesus.
Well, you know, some of us can't have it because we're so stretched out in bills.
No.
So we just believe we need to take care of that first. And then give God the leftovers.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, please don't become a leftover Christian.
All right.
Don't be a leftover Christian. You know, because God doesn't practice in leftover business. You are first class citizens with God. He gives us the best every day of our life. Watch this. And he gives us fresh mercy every day.
Yes.
Not yesterday, but every day we get fresh mercy. And you're going to make him leftover?
Yes.
A leftover God? I know I'm chasing a rabbit, but I don't mind. I'm going to kill that sucker.